From its construction to its mission to the things it discovered and more. Join us as we tell you about the Spitzer Space Telescope history and mission overview. When it comes to space, there's only so much that we can learn from where we are on Earth. Thus, over the course of history, various astronomers have used things like telescopes to try and learn about the solar system, our galaxy, other galaxies, and the universe in general. But even with the most powerful of telescopes, they are not able to go and scan and learn everything they can. So with the invention of satellites and probes, NASA and other agencies made space telescopes to go send into space to collect more data. And one of the most famous ones that was retired recently was that of the Spitzer Space Telescope. The Spitzer Space Telescope was the final mission in NASA's Great Observatories program, a family of four space-based observatories, each observing the universe in a different kind of light. The other missions in the program included the Visible Light Hubble Space Telescope, HST, Compton Gamma-Ray Observatory, CGRO, and the Chandra X-Ray Observatory, CXO. Spitzer specifically was an infrared space telescope launched in 2003 and retired on January 30th, 2020. Spitzer was designed to detect infrared radiation, which is primarily heat radiation. It is comprised of two major components. The cryogenic telescope assembly, which contains the 85-centimeter telescope, and Spitzer's three scientific instruments. The spacecraft, which controls the telescope, provides power to the instruments, handles the scientific data, and communicates with Earth. It may seem like a contradiction, but NASA's Spitzer Space Telescope had to be simultaneously warm and cold to function properly. Everything in the cryogenic telescope assembly must be cooled to only a few degrees above absolute zero, minus 459 degrees Fahrenheit or minus 273 degrees Celsius. This is achieved with an onboard tank of liquid helium, or cryogen. Meanwhile, electronic equipment in the spacecraft portion needed to operate near room temperature. Spitzer's highly sensitive instruments allowed scientists to peer into cosmic regions that are hidden from optical telescopes, including dusty stellar nurseries, the centers of galaxies, and newly forming planetary systems. Spitzer's infrared eyes also allowed astronomers to see cooler objects in space, like failed stars, brown dwarfs, extrasolar planets, giant molecular clouds, and organic molecules that may hold the secret to life on other planets. So as you can see, this was a very important mission, and one that actually went on a lot longer than it was originally intended to, much to the joy of those who studied its findings. You see, Spitzer was originally built to last for a minimum of 2.5 years, but it lasted in the cold phase for over 5.5 years. On May 15, 2009, the coolant was finally depleted and the Spitzer's warm mission began. Operating with two channels from one of its instruments called IRAC, Spitzer was able to continue to operate until the year 2020, when it was finally retired by NASA. Now, earlier we noted that the Spitzer had a set of three scientific instruments that would allow it to scan space. Let's detail those for you now. First was the Infrared Array Camera, IRAC. An infrared camera which operates simultaneously on four wavelengths, 3.6 micrometer, 4.5 micrometer, 5.8 micrometer, and 8 micrometer. Each module uses a 256 by 256 pixel detector. The short wavelength pair use indium antimonide technology. The long wavelength pair use arsenic doped silicon impurity band construction technology. The principal investigator is Giovanni Fazio of Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics. The flight hardware was built by NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center. Second on the Spitzer satellite was the infrared spectrograph, IRS. An infrared spectrometer with four sub-modules which operate at the wavelengths 5.3 to 14 micrometers, low resolution, 10 to 19.5 micrometers, high resolution, 14 to 40 micrometers, low resolution, and 19 to 37 micrometers, high resolution. Each module uses a 128 by 128 pixel detector. The short wavelength pair use arsenic doped silicon blocked impurity band technology. The long wavelength pair use antimony doped silicon blocked impurity band technology. The principal investigator was James R. Husick of Cornell University. The flight hardware was built by Ball Aerospace. Finally, there was the multi-band imaging photometer for Spitzer, MIPS. Three detector arrays in the far infrared, 128 by 128 pixels at 24 micrometers, 32 by 32 pixels at 70 micrometers, 2 by 20 pixels at 160 micrometers. The 24 micrometer detector is identical to the one on the IRS short wavelength modules. The 70 micrometer detector uses gallium doped germanium technology, and the 160 micrometer detector also uses gallium doped germanium, but with mechanical stress added to each pixel to lower the band gap and extend sensitivity to this long wavelength. The principal investigator is George H. Reike of the University of Arizona. The flight hardware was built by Ball Aerospace. Each of these tools were vital for the missions that it had and brought forth a lot of information about space. But what kind of information exactly? Before we dive into that info, be sure to like or dislike the video. That way we can continue to improve our content for you, the viewer. Also, be sure to subscribe to the channel so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. The first images taken by Spitzer Space Telescope were designed to show off the abilities of the telescope and showed a glowing stellar nursery, a big swirling dusty galaxy, a disk of planet-forming debris and organic material in the distant universe. Since then, many monthly press releases have highlighted Spitzer's capabilities, each with their own unique photos and explanations of what have been found. As one of its most noteworthy observations, in 2005, the Spitzer became the first telescope to directly capture light from exoplanets, namely the hot Jupiters, HD 209458b and TRES-1b, although it did not resolve that light into actual images, to be clear. This was the first time extrasolar planets had actually been visually seen. Earlier observations had been indirectly made by drawing conclusions from behaviors of the stars the planets were orbiting. The telescope also discovered in April 2005 that Cohen-Coohee-Tau/4 had a planetary disk that was vastly younger and contained less mass than previously theorized, leading to new understandings of how planets are formed. So just within the first 2 years of its mission, the Spitzer Space Telescope had already radically changed how we thought about the universe, and more specifically, helped us fill in puzzle pieces, if you will, about how planets are made. And this was just one of many revelations and results that the telescope made. Would you like to hear more of them? In 2004, it was reported that Spitzer had spotted a faintly glowing body that may be the youngest star ever seen. The telescope was trained on a core of gas and dust known as L1014, which had previously appeared completely dark to ground-based observatories and to ISO, Infrared Space Observatory, a predecessor to Spitzer. The advanced technology of Spitzer revealed a bright red spot in the middle of L1014. Scientists from the University of Texas in Austin, who discovered the object, believed the hotspot to be an example of early star development, with the young star collecting gas and dust from the cloud around it. Early speculation about the hotspot was that it might have been the faint light of another core that lies 10 times further from Earth, but along the same line of sight as L1014. Follow-up observation from ground-based near-infrared observatories detected a faint fan-shaped glow in the same location as the object found by Spitzer. That glow is too feeble to have come from the more distant core, leading to the conclusion that the object is located within L1014. Heading back to 2005, astronomers from the University of Wisconsin at Madison and Whitewater determined on the basis of 400 hours of observation on the Spitzer Space Telescope that the Milky Way galaxy has a more substantial bar structure across its core than previously recognized, which is important as the shape of the universe and galaxies in general are a major thing in astronomy. Not all galaxies are shaped the way we believe them to be, and how they fill up the universe as a whole is something debated quite often. Also in 2005, astronomers Alexander Kishlinsky and John Mather of NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center reported that one of Spitzer's earliest images may have captured the light of the first stars in the universe. Think about that for a second. It didn't capture the light of any star, but possibly some of the first stars to ever be made in the universe as a whole. An image of a quasar in the Draco constellation, intended only to help calibrate the telescope, was found to contain an infrared glow after the light of known objects was removed. Kuklinski and Mather are convinced that the numerous blobs in this glow are the light of stars that formed as early as 100 million years after the Big Bang, redshifted by cosmic expansion. While this wasn't definitively proven, it's still something that proves how valuable this satellite was, because a simple test about refining the telescope led to a discovery that could truly help define the timeline of the universe in certain aspects. That's very impressive, don't you think? In March 2006, astronomers reported an 80 light-year long, 25 PC nebula near the center of the Milky Way galaxy, the Double Helix Nebula, which is, as the name implies, twisted into a double spiral shape. This is thought to be evidence of massive magnetic fields generated by the gas disk orbiting the supermassive black hole at the galaxy center, 300 light-years, 92 PC from the nebula, and 25,000 light-years, 7,700 PC from Earth. This nebula was discovered by Spitzer and published in the magazine Nature in March 2006. In May 2007, astronomers successfully mapped the atmospheric temperature of HD 189733b, thus obtaining the first map of some kind of an extrasolar planet. In addition, the study revealed that roaring winds likely whip through the planet's atmosphere. This image shows an artist's impression of the planet. Heading now to the back half of Spitzer's life, observations revealed in May of 2011 that indicate that tiny phosphorite crystals might be falling down like rain onto the protostar Hop 68. The discovery of the phosphorite crystals in the outer collapsing cloud of the protostar is surprising because the crystals form at lava-like high temperatures, yet they are found in the molecular cloud where the temperatures are about minus 170 degrees Celsius, 103 Kelvin, minus 274 degrees Fahrenheit. This led the team of astronomers to speculate that the bipolar outflow from the young star may be transporting the phosphorite crystals from near the star's surface to the chilly outer cloud. In April 2015, Spitzer and the Optical Gravitational Lensing Experiment were reported as co-discovering one of the most distant planets ever identified, a gas giant about 13,000 light-years, 4,000 PC away from Earth. In June and July of 2015, the brown dwarf OGLE-2015-BLG-1319 was discovered using the gravitational microlensing direction method in a joint effort between SWIFT, Spitzer, and the ground-based optical gravitational lensing experiment, the first time two space telescopes have observed the same microlensing event. In March 2016, Spitzer and Hubble were used to discover the most distant known galaxy, GNZ-11. This object was seen as it appeared 13.4 billion years ago. For the record, most speculate that the universe is about 13.8 billion years old, so this was a galaxy that was around within a half a billion years of the Big Bang. But if you think these were all discoveries of Spitzer, you're underestimating the team behind the device. Spitzer was also put to work studying exoplanets thanks to creatively tweaking its hardware. This included doubling its stability by modifying its heating cycle, finding a new use for the peek-up camera, and analyzing the sensor at a sub-pixel level. Although in its warm mission, the spacecraft's passive cooling system kept the sensors at 29 Kelvin, minus 244 degrees Celsius, minus 407 degrees Fahrenheit. Spitzer can use the transit photometry and gravitational microlensing techniques to perform these observations. According to NASA's Sean Carey, "We never even considered using Spitzer for studying exoplanets when it launched. It would have seemed ludicrous back then, but now it's an important part of what Spitzer does." One of the most famous things that it found was a set of seven planets that were all Earth-sized, and all orbiting a single star known as TRAPPIST-1. This is the largest batch of Earth-sized planets ever discovered in a single system. This amazing planetary system has inspired scientists and non-scientists alike. Three of the planets sit in the habitable zone around the star, where temperatures might be right to support liquid water on a planet's surface. The discovery represents a major step in the search for life beyond our solar system. Sadly, all good things must come to an end. Where once it could transmit data continuously, it was only able to manage just 2.5 hours per day before its battery drained in the latter points of its life. The telescope was retired on January 30, 2020, when NASA sent a shutdown signal to the telescope from the Goldstone Deep Space Communication Complex, GDSCC, instructing the telescope to go into safe mode. After receiving confirmation that the command was successful, Spitzer Project Manager Joseph Hunt officially declared that the mission had ended. Still in the roughly 17 years of its mission life, the Spitzer Space Telescope revealed so much about the universe that we're still talking about it to this day. From helping mapping out the Milky Way galaxy, to teaching us more about how planets form, to helping us find brand new planets and more. Even one of these discoveries would have been worth the price of admission, but so many in such a period of time, that's remarkable. And as such, the Spitzer Space Telescope should be praised as a triumph on many levels. You almost have to pity the space telescopes that come after it because they have quite the legacy to live up to. Thanks for watching, everyone. What did you think of this look at the Spitzer Space Telescope and the mission that only recently ended? Were you surprised that the satellite not only lasted that long, but was able to give that much data to scientists? What do you think will be the next great telescope to get information about space? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.